Good afternoon, everybody, and also thanks to the organization for the opportunity to speak here today. So indeed, I will talk about BlueSynth, and which is, in my opinion, an example of the drive of my company for sustainability and sustainability in AM. So we are not only driven by sustainability in AM, but also in sustainability in general, of course. My role at Materialize is a research manager, so I'm working in a division called Central Research and Technology. And I'm driving big innovation projects for our three business units, which are dealing mostly with manufacturing processes and software. Before I start, I want to spend a few minutes about what Materialize actually is doing. So Materialize is a company that was founded in 1990. As Professor De Vloer already said, so from the beginning, we had a very, very tight collaboration with University of Leuven, and it's still going on. Illustrated in this Green AM project that we currently have together. And since the beginning, Materialize is really looking at empowering meaningful applications through 3D printing. So we always start in whatever activities that we do to find out where 3D printing really makes, brings meaning, economic, ecologic, where it adds value, and then we develop the technology to make that happen. So CEO is still Wilfried van Kraan, who founded the company also in 1990. And since the beginning, our tagline has been to develop a better and healthier world, which is of course quite broad. That means that we also don't do any weapons or any military things, which is, by the way, a very big funding in other countries for military, unfortunately. But this is sometimes how the world works, of course. So Materialize is built around three core competences, which you see here in this slide. So we believe we are pretty good at 3D printing. So we operate close to 300 industrial printers worldwide. So we have printing hubs in Belgium, in Leuven, of course, or HQ. We have we print in Germany, in Bremen, in Poland, in Czech Republic, in the US. We are also strong in engineering, meaning we look at applications where 3D printing can be of use, and we develop also very often these applications together with our customers in so-called verticals. And one extreme example is all our activities, of course, we do in medical printing, and we have a very big suite of medical components that we bring to the medical industry, from guides to 3D printing, 3D printed customized implants. And especially very important for us and our business is for everything that we do related to software development. So 3D printing is a digital technology. And of course, software is all over the place, from design, how to get a part on the printer itself. Now also data collection, learning from data, and so on. So software is of course a key. Now, Materialize has a lot of competition in each of these fields. There are many large manufacturing companies that are going into 3D printing. Many application development companies are there that want to bring 3D printing in a very specific niche. Big software development companies, the CAD or mass PLM vendors are there. But what makes us still unique is the synergy that we can create between these core competences. To give an illustration, this is also what my responsibility is in the company. We operate hundreds of 3D printers. They run on our own software tools. So we have a lot of opportunities to learn from every day in our shop floor. We learn a lot about where our software is strong and where it is not yet strong, or where it fails, or where there are things to improve. And if we can successfully develop solutions, software solutions, to overcome these challenges in-house, we then look at how we can bring these software solutions to external customers. And this is a dynamic that we still have ongoing a lot, which will also come back, by the way, in my own in the real topic of this presentation. So last thing, how we are structured as a business. We have these core competences and so on. We bring them to the market in three different business units. So we have Materialize Software, so where we bring technical software to the market to bring 3D printed files, CAD files on the machine, tools for data management. We have a new CO-AM platform that is cloud-based smart data platform, and so on. We have a manufacturing unit, so we print about 2 million parts per year for different industries, going from prototypes to small series. And then we have a large medical unit where we bring specific digital applications, so software and 3D printed implants to the medical industry. Okay, I want to talk today about one specific 3D printing technology that we are using. So it's laser sintering, and this already came back in the presentation of Professor Dufou right before this presentation. So laser sintering is one of the 3D printing modalities that we use at Materialise, and one of the important ones. So we have, I think, roughly maybe 80 machines that we are operating in Poland, in Belgium, in the medical facilities, and so on. So laser sintering is a powder bed based process. So you spread a layer of powder with a recoater, you sinter locally in each layer where you want to have material by means of a CO2 laser. You spread a new layer of powder and so on, and this is where you build up a product. You can make in laser sintering very strong nylon-based parts. And we use it a lot for industrial applications as well as for medical applications. So there is a broad, in a certain sense, for 3D printing, there is a broad material palette available. And so we operate around 10 materials, very small for injection molding, but rather big for additive manufacturing. But what we mostly produce in is polyamide 12. So if you look at our machines, I think around 95% of these machines are printing parts in polyamide 12, so nylon. And there are some variants there, glass filled, fire resistant versions, and so on. We consume around 60 ton per year, maybe a little bit more. That's about the number. And we are also a certified producer for aerospace, among others for Airbus. So we can also produce certified parts in laser sintering. That already was discussed by Professor Dufou also, so I will go over that briefly. But if you look at the feedstock use in laser sintering, so you produce, or we buy actually powder that is being produced by a powder manufacturer. That powder is, first of all, before it goes into the machine, is mixed with used powder. So the fresh powder, or the virgin powder, is mixed with used powder. I will come back to that later on, why this is being done. It goes in the SLS machine. Unfortunately, the transformation of powder into parts is only around 10%. So we 10% of the powder that has been in the machine is turned into parts. The rest is unused powder from the printing process. It's being sieved. So there's some powder that is lost after sieving, and because it has been quite cakey. And then we reuse that powder. Some of the powder is quality controlled. The powder is quality controlled. Some of them is then being ditched. And then we mix it again with fresh powder. So there's a mixing ratio of around 55-45 in industrial production. So average, you can say 50-50. That's a problem. So we generate a lot of waste material. And that makes also that it is a very expensive process, and also a very expensive process in terms of the ecological footprint. And that's also what has been discussed by Professor Dufou. If you look at these are numbers that come from K. Leuven, from the study by Carl Callens, who did his PhD with Professor Dufou. And you see that actually the environmental footprint of laser sintering is dominated by waste powder because of the very large amount of energy that is needed in producing the powder. And then of course the laser sintering is a thermal process. You need to preheat the whole machine until 170 degrees. So it also consumes quite some energy. That is of course the second main factor in this. So Materialise operates 80 machines. We see this issue with the not so good sustainability of laser sintering. And a few years ago, we wanted to do something about it. First of all, why do we actually mix? First of all, using virgin powder would be nice because you have good quality, but this is of course very unsustainable. So if you only use fresh powder and then you throw it away, it's really extremely expensive and very unsustainable. Secondly, so that's why we do the mixing. But why don't we completely reuse the powder? It is because if you completely reuse powder in a machine, so if you 100% reuse the powder, no mixing with virgin powder, you get a very bad surface quality. It's called orange peel. You see in this part, it's like rough, very rough surface. And our customers do really not accept this quality. So they think that although the material properties are not much worse than the normal mixing, they think that the part quality is bad and they do not accept it. So we cannot sell any parts with this rough surface. So we need to do the mixing. We have tried in our production, we have tried several steps in the last 10 years to, or several projects we had in the last years to get that mixing ratio up. So to get closer to, as close as possible to 100% reused powder, but we never succeeded in doing this. Then in around 2014, 2015, we started a very in-depth study about the chemistry of laser sintering, also together with the University of Leuven, but a different research team as the group of Joost. And there we had a few PhD students that looked together with us in what actually happens deep down in this laser material interaction. I will not go into this in detail, but we really investigated if a laser scans over a material, over the material. And so you have this powder material that's going to melt when the laser hits the powder surface. And we have actually found out that there are two effects that are not so nice. In the used powder, so the old powder, the powder is melting and it's not flowing a lot, so it's the coalescence is quite bad. That's what you should understand from this picture, but I will not go in detail. But the second problem is that also there is a higher tendency to shrink or to warp because used powder has been in a machine that had a very extensive thermal cycle already, and there are more granules or more crystals in the material. It makes that the material, so after you have sintered with the laser, it makes that it also tends to shrink more. And this shrinkage actually results into the effect that the layer wants to shrink, as every layer wants to shrink, and then this actually is the cause of the orange peel. So the orange peel, the orange peel effect, with hot powder, it has more shrinkage and it wants to shrink more, and you get this orange peel effect on the sides. Actually, what I want to bring here is that we fully unraveled the physical mechanisms behind what is the difference in the virgin, the 50-50 mix, and the old. We completely understood what happened, but then also we found a solution for this, and the solution actually is in a normal machine, you will have a laser that is actually just scanning every layer with a certain scanning path that we define in our software. And if you would look at the thermal cycle that a certain point in the material in the layer actually feels, so the laser scans over it, it's going to increase in temperature and then going to decrease in temperature again. And this is a very rapid cycle. And we found out that if we actually not scan one time, but two times, but with a dedicated process parameter set and a dedicated timing in between these multiple passes, we can actually in the first pass melt the crystals and then in the second pass melt the material. So in this way we can actually overcome that orange peel effect. So this is what you see here. So we have actually designed a very special way of printing, where we not scan only once, but we scan twice, and with a dedicated timing of the laser and with dedicated process parameters. Now, if you look, we made a few test prints, and I still remember that very well. I went to a big boss, the CEO, Fried van Kraan. I put him a part on the table and I said, look, Fried, this part has been made with 100% recycled powder and it is still of very, very high quality. I said, Tom, this is amazing. We need to bring this into production. But if you want to bring this in production, with a single laser machine, you will actually double your printing time, because in the layer printing, you not, as I said, you do not need to scan only once, but twice. So we needed also to adapt the machines to overcome this problem. So what we did is we designed a dual laser laser sintering machine, and you had already dual laser sintering machines on the market, but they just actually were scanning each on an own surface with a very small overlap. We were the first that actually designed a laser sintering machine with a full overlap, so where the two lasers actually could work together on a single scan field. And what you see here in this image from a thermal camera, and you see that, I will play it again, you see that one laser is doing, you see here, one laser doing a preheating pass, and the second laser is doing full sintering. That preheat, the timing between the preheating and the actual sintering is very well controlled, so it's a quite complex algorithm that actually determines what each laser needs to do and the sequence between the passes and so on. So we designed that machine, and our CEO said, okay, let's call it green machines, because these green machines do allow to print in used powder, and they are actually ecologically much more much better. So we called it green machines that was in 2018, and then over the time we have built 7 of these green machines that are now operational in our production. As I will tell later, we also worked together with the Korean machine manufacturer Sindo, that actually brought these green machines also on the market and in the Sindo machines. So at the moment in Matthias, we operate 7 green machines that are in-house built, and then 5 green machines that come from Sindo, so in total 12 machines. And also as a brand, so we also now sell parts in the used powder, and we call it BlueSint. So BlueSint is actually the offering. So we offer polyamide 12 parts, but then with reused powder instead of, so 100% reused powder instead of the normal mix. Here was a video that I will share the link about a summary of BlueSint. I will not play that. What I can tell you, so here are also some numbers that we did. So to compare the normal way of printing with the BlueSint. So we computed that we estimated that we have a CO2 reduction for 1 kilo of polyamide 12 of about around 32%. It's nice. It's of course not it's not 200%, or it's not like halving, but it's like the best that we can get out of this technology, and this is of course an quite good achievement. We also checked of course on the mechanical properties, because we still want to make sure that property wise the parts are fine. And what you see here is that there is these are parts that are printed in different directions, and you see this is the BlueSint and this is the conventional made. You see that there is a very low difference. There is a difference, but it's of course low. But there is a small difference in the mechanical properties, and that is due to still some coalescence in the layers. We can of course explain it, but this is well above the threshold for our customers. Here are some examples of parts that we print. So they are identical in quality compared to the normal parts. They are a little bit more rough, but in many applications actually roughness is not such a big effect. Now, as a last thing, how do we use that in production? So we want to also of course offer BlueSint in industrial scale. So the 3 pictures of the machines that we have built, or that we are now using from Sindo. So we have at the moment, from the Sindo machines, we have 5 machines in operation. There are still some to come for next year. And so we use these machines together with our 7 green machines for producing parts in BlueSint. But we also look at production of and optimization of certain applications with 3D printing. And one of the applications that we are serving is the foodware industry. We had in 2014, we founded a joint venture that's not 100% Materialize, called Materialize Motion. And in Materialize Motion, we bring customized insoles to the market. So here you see some parts. So it is customized insoles for sports and customized insoles for professionals that need to stand a lot in the day, like a nurse or in construction, construction workers, and so on. And we fully customize these the mechanical properties of these insoles in function of the dynamic gait pattern of the person. This is one application that we completely serve now with BlueSense. We produce several 10,000 pairs of this this year. Here I think we make we made quite a big step in not only cost, of course, because we can bring these parts much cheaper to the market, but also in terms of sustainability to print these parts. And this is what I had to say during my talk today. And of course, I'm open for questions.